Hello, everyone. Welcome. If you look at the average number of connected devices today, an average household has about 4 devices. And you look at how content is being delivered, about a quarter of the people in the ages 25 to 34 are primarily consuming content on these connected devices. Yet, delivering on these connected devices is actually challenging. And the reason is, the internet, which is the medium on which these devices are being streamed, is by definition lossy. Packet losses of the order of 0.05% are not uncommon on the internet today. On that note, I'm Prasad Kalyanraman. Welcome to the presentation on raising the bar on video quality streaming using AWS. So why is quality actually important? Now, if you actually plotted the popularity of title to a measure of quality, and I'll discuss what quality actually means, there's a fairly strong correlation between the number of minutes customers view video versus the quality that they actually see. And this is why it's actually really important. It matters to your customers, and it matters to you because it's the amount of time you have your customers engaged so that you can monetize that content. So what do you expect to get from the session? 3 things. Number one, I'll talk about what metrics that you can use for quality and how it's relevant for your specific use case. Then I'll actually pass the talk on to Jim Freeman. Jim runs Amazon Video, and he'll talk about how Amazon Video ensures that its customers have the best quality experience. And finally, I'll talk about how AWS helped Amazon Video achieve its goals. So let me start with a very quick primer on streaming. So any media workflow actually has 5 major functions. Okay. You can broadly separate them into processing of content and delivery of content. Processing has 3 major functions inside it. Ingest, which is how you actually get the contribution feeds, how you transcode this content, how you process, store, and prepare the assets for delivery, how you deliver this content through a CDN, and finally, what analytics and metrics do you gather about this content so that you can actually feed it back into your media workflow. Now, traditionally, this has been done through hardware-based appliances which were purpose-built. So you had things like contribution feed processors, you had decoders, you had multiplexers, you had these HD encoders, SD encoders, and so on. And you created an entire workflow using these hardware-based devices. Fast forward to today, that exact same media workflow has been translated into a set of services that actually run in virtualized environments. There are 2 major advantages of this. One is you're changing needs in terms of players and devices that are being used to consume this content is actually putting a burden on customers to be able to process this content in all these different formats. So you need agility such that you can actually react to all these changing needs. And 2, media workflows have traditionally been unpredictable in their volumes. So you needed a virtualized environment where you can actually burst for all these content requirements. So what does quality really mean, and how do you measure it? There are primarily 4 metrics that you can use for measuring quality. Okay. The number one is errors. That means, do you get an HTTP 200 back to your viewer, or is the viewer able to stream the content? Number 2, the number of rebuffer sessions that they see as they're actually streaming this content. That means, how many rebuffers do they see per session? 3 is the average bit rate that you use for streaming this content. And 4, the time to first frame. Now, depending on your specific use case, these metrics might have different value propositions. So for example, if you're actually looking at 4K connected device delivery, your average bit rate is probably a lot more important than time to first frame. It's also important that these metrics are captured at fairly detailed levels. That means you want to understand these metrics at a per player, per device, per network, and so on. Now, it's not sufficient if you just looked at quality and you said these are the metrics that you actually capture. You need to be able to tie this back to to your server-side metrics. And the reason why you have to do that is because your client-side telemetry informs you what is happening on the server side, and unless you're able to tie those things together, you can't make improvements to the quality that you're actually providing to your end users. With that, I'd like to pass this on to Jim Freeman. Jim runs Amazon Video, and it's actually a customer of AWS, and he'll talk about how they focused on quality for their end users. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Prasad. Prasad, thank you again. Hello, everyone. As Prasad said, I am responsible for Amazon's digital video business. And today, what I want to talk to you about is some of the challenges we faced in delivering premium video to our customers and some of the progress we've made in doing that better over time. My hope is that you will learn today some techniques that you can apply to your own business to improve your customer experience. And you can also put into context the value of the work the CloudFront team is doing to improve video delivery. Before we jump into that, a little bit about Amazon Video. Amazon Video offers Amazon Prime members tens of thousands of movies and TV episodes included at no charge with their Prime membership, and also access to over 100,000 titles to rent or buy. Amazon Video is the only video subscription service that also includes the ability to download subscription titles, and we're the only service that combines both the subscription, rent, and buy experience in one unified application. To make our content more compelling for our Amazon Prime members, we've also founded Amazon Studios. Amazon Studios is where we develop television shows, such as the award-winning show Transparent, and the upcoming adaptation of Philip K. Dick's novel, The Man in the High Castle. Before we dive into some of the technical details, I'd like to share with you just a little bit of the content that we have available to customers.
Just a person, and here we are. And baby, you need to get in this whirlpool, or you need to get out of it.
This was not a rehearsal, this was a performance.
Yeah, and a really good one.
It's unsanctioned.
Yeah, it's unsanctioned, it was unhinged. It's earthy, it's happening, and I have never seen these rosy cheeks of yours. Look at that.
Who's in charge?
Visions that I'm seeing, they're real. God is speaking to me through PJ.
What is God telling you to do?
Get the man who hurt my boy.
This summer job's a great start. Okay, you meet people, you make contacts, there's gonna be a lot of wealthy people who are gonna remember you down the road when they need someone to do their taxes, okay?
It shows us winning the war.
But we didn't win the war.
That's what they told us.
I know, they look real.
Yeah, they look real because they are real.
Please help me!
Let her go. You said you like to look people in the eyes when you talk to them. Why don't you come out here and look into mine?
You can take my hand. You can take my heart. I'll be ready and waiting for you here. In the streets I live. In the home.
And to allow our content creators and storytellers to connect with their audience. And we can do that and do that well when we deliver a flawless playback experience But imagine, instead of watching that video and finding yourself intrigued by one or more of the shows presented, the video was very grainy. Or the video stopped multiple times just at the wrong time when the story is getting super interesting. Well, we're here today to talk a little bit about some of those types of issues, how we've addressed them in the Amazon Video team, and how we've worked with CloudFront to address those issues. So as Prasad mentioned, trade-offs are really important. And in this space, in the premium video space, where content's paid for, we think about those trade-offs a little bit differently than you might if you were delivering short-form video, for example, or ad-supported video. So first of all, if you buy a video on Amazon, you definitely expect to be able to watch that video. Reliability is paramount. Ultimately, delivering the product is number one. Two, in a subscription video service where you can sample many different titles, lowering the latency of playback start time aids content discovery significantly. You can sample many more videos if videos start in less than 1 second than you can sample, or you have the frustration of trying to sample many videos if it takes 15 seconds to load each video. Finally, video quality is important. The visual quality that customers expect does vary by screen, but ultimately, we see digital video as an opportunity to deliver enhanced quality above and beyond Blu-ray with initiatives we have such as HDR and Ultra HD. The challenge I've put to my team is that we need to constantly invent ways to push the boundaries where these trade-offs are made. And the team is making a lot of progress on that. So obviously, we all understand that you can't improve what you can't measure. And Prasad talked about a couple of different ways to measure things, measuring on the server side, measuring within your infrastructure, measuring at the client side. We're going to talk more about that. And customer trust is essential. If you buy a video on Amazon, we do not deliver that video to you. You may choose not to shop again in the future on Amazon. And when we realized early on that we were not always living up to our customers' expectations, we decided that preserving customer trust was one of the most important things we needed to do. And so we invented a program that would be a customer trust safeguard, and that's our automatic refund program. What you see here is a quick excerpt from one of the emails that's sent to a customer. It's basically a notice saying we've proactively refunded someone's rental of a video because we realized they were unable to play it during their rental period. That's one example of the kind of tactics we've applied as we improve. So why is this hard? It's a scale problem, and in any scale problem, as you know, everything that can fail is failing at some percent. Let's look at some of the numbers. Tens of millions of customers, over 500 different unique types of devices, different operating systems, different Wi-Fi chipsets, different application development platforms, different video players, et cetera, different streaming protocols. How many end user networks we're delivering to? Over 23,000 individual end user networks, and we're doing that through multiple CDN partners, including CloudFront. So now you have to understand the performance of all those different unique pathways through the internet. We also have over 600,000 unique titles, which results in over 5.4 million encodes based on the different streaming formats, bit rates we support. Ultimately, because we're using adaptive bitrate technologies, that comes down to over 50 billion video fragments that are being managed. So delivering in that complexity, delivering quality in a situation where you have this much complexity over an unreliable network is the primary challenge for premium video. So I'm going to tell you about some of our early days, some of the challenges we faced early on when we were building Amazon Video, and then I'll share with you some of the learnings that we've applied to those situations. First of all, in the early days, we had metrics, and we looked at reports, but what we could not truly tell is how important those metrics were. We did not know at that time exactly what level of customer drop-off there would be for what types of errors, or how it affected customer perception of the service as well. We also had fairly rudimentary error handling and network degradation strategies in terms of recovery logic, so that was fairly limited. There were many devices, and in the early days of smart TVs and streaming media players, there was a lot of different technology being applied, and a lot of that technology is no longer available, but it was a time where there was a lot of diversity and not a lot of robustness in these platforms. As I mentioned earlier, understanding network congestion is extremely important, and we had somewhat limited telemetry along those lines that held us back. Because of our large catalog, we also had low cache hit ratios on the CDNs. Entertainment content has heavy demand at the head of the catalog and then has a very long tail of content that customers enjoy, but at lower frequency. And we did not have the fundamental thing we needed, and which is what I'm here to talk about, which is a fully closed feedback loop. We looked at reports, we took actions, we did projects, we made improvements, but it was not a closed feedback loop. So a simple framework for improving most things would be to measure, to improve and act, and then to close the feedback loop fully. So measuring the customer experience in video really boils down to deciding what it is that you want to understand exactly about your customer experience. You can't understand the customer experience from a server log. You can definitely diagnose issues that are customer impacting with a server log, but you can't totally understand it that way. You need to be able to see and affect what the customer sees. And to do that, you have to have metrics like how many frames per second are being rendered without frame drops. How long is the video pausing when it does pause, and how many times did it do that? Did the video actually fail, and the customer had to click play again? What bit rates were delivered to the customer? Those sorts of things. Visualization's not enough, but it is a start. This gets you a little bit of the way there. And what we've found is the biggest issue here is simply that the diversity of platforms that are being targeted by our service, that there's no easy solution. There's no solution that does not involve building software. There are many solutions out there that might be able to help you out a little bit on the web or help you in some limited set of context. But if your goal is to truly deliver a multi-platform service and to understand what your customer sees, my assessment is you're going to have to build some of your own software to make that happen. As Prasad mentioned, and this is a slightly different view, every percentage gain improvement in video quality results in higher customer engagement, longer video views, et cetera. I'm going to talk about two basic components of our software, the video player side and the server side. And on the video player side, I'm just sharing with you a few of the key ideas we have found to be particularly meaningful in terms of improving video playback performance. First of all, adaptive bitrate streaming is now pretty much the norm. MPEG-Dash, HLS, Microsoft Smooth Streaming, etc. We use all of these technologies. One thing we have found in that particular area is that it's very important to be mindful of what bit rates you've developed, what bit rates you offer to different clients, and you may see different behavior across different clients. So we don't always deliver the exact same set of bit rates to all of our clients because that's not been proven to be optimal. We do a lot of A/B testing to determine what the right mix is in the adaptive bit rate world. Second is CDN switching. While it's our objective to always route the customer to the best performing CDN for their playback stream, We also believe that it's critically important to be able to recover in real time. If we were delivering 2-minute videos, we might not think so strongly that this is critical, but in the long form video world, it's very important to be able to ensure that your customer is always on the best performing CDN. DNS failures can be particularly troublesome, and sometimes they're not as black and white as you might expect. We've definitely seen failure modes that are specific to content streaming and not just overall application performance. So having a good strategy for that is super important. And then, assuming you're delivering the content over HTTP, we've definitely found that concurrent downloads through a thread pool is a way to maximize throughput and to get customers higher quality video. So those are some ideas. The second thing I want to talk about is what we call our CDN balancer. Perhaps not the best term, but the general mission of this piece of software is to ensure that we are using all of our pathways to deliver content to our customers optimally. And optimal is measured through our customer experience metrics that we have instrumented in our player. So things like bitrate delivered, visual and audio quality, rebuffering, and error reduction, et cetera. The idea behind the CDN balancer, though, is a good one, because what we want to do is let the data we've gathered about customer performance across CDNs, devices, streaming protocols, and in certain geographies, and use that data to help customers avoid problems rather than have to recover from those problems. And so by building the assessment of all current video playback performance and using that data to make decisions about where new streams start or where streams migrate to if there are issues, we optimize the total customer experience. A little graphic to give you an idea of what I'm talking about. We use multiple CDNs. We feed all those metrics continuously back into the Amazon Video backend. We use a lot of AWS services to build this, and then we make these decisions about where the streams are routed to. Here you can see some of the services that we're using to ingest metrics, process metrics, and then ultimately make decisions about where content is streamed from. And this is the key idea of closing the feedback loop. Early on in our pursuit of improved video performance, we used to look at a lot of reports, we would do a lot of deep dives, look at a lot of data, and then we would come up with very real material improvements we could make to our service. But we were basically doing them sort of one at a time with a team of people, and it was taking a long time. So we aspired to close the loop so that our system was doing a lot of this for us and making many thousands of decisions where previously we could only make tens of decisions. So by closing the loop, we've really accelerated our ability to improve the customer experience. The results in aggregate are that we have reduced playback defects by 87% while increasing our scale 270x. And I'd definitely like to thank the teams back in Seattle, London, and Bangalore for their hard work in making those improvements possible. So thank you. And here you can just see some of our journey with Amazon Video and AWS. It's definitely a partnership where we have scaled and we have increased our adoption of AWS over time. You can see here some of the key milestones, our recent launch of Prime Video in Japan, for example, on the business side, but also you can see many milestones where we adopted EC2 for video transcoding, for example, and our accelerated adoption of CloudFront as well. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Prasad, who's going to explain some of the specific details of how the CloudFront team has innovated to support Amazon Video.
Thank you, Jim. It's actually a pretty inspiring presentation, given where Amazon Video has come along in the last few years. And in fact, I've actually had conversations with Jim about how long it took to build this feedback loop and how big a team he has.
has a pretty small team, and they did this in a very short period of time. So what I'm going to talk about is some of the capabilities that we had to build to actually support the needs for Amazon Video. Now, Amazon Video is a customer of ours, is a large customer of ours, and obviously a demanding customer, as you can look by the metrics that they've been using for delivering a high-quality experience. But this infrastructure that we actually build is available across our broad set of media customers. And in fact, it's being used by many of our media customers as well. So before I go further, let me tell you what the workload actually means to CDNs. Okay. What we call internally Amazon Video's demand profile is a long-tail demand profile, which means 10% of the video catalog is responsible for 95% of the video streams. And the schematic on the right actually shows the relationships between the quality that Amazon Video uses to measure their performance to the popularity of titles. And as you can see, the two metrics that we actually had was the number of sessions without any errors and the number of sessions without any rebuffers. And when you plotted that with the popularity of titles, what you saw was that for the very popular titles, you could easily actually have very high quality delivered to your customers. Okay. What was harder was as the popularity of content decreased, you saw a fairly significant degradation in that rebuffer sessions or the errors. So why don't traditional CDNs deal with this long tail content very well? And if you look through the reasons for it, there are actually primarily three reasons. One is, there is a limited amount of storage at these edge locations. And these edge locations are tens of servers distributed primarily in colo facilities and transit centers. And those locations do not have the capacity to store hundreds of racks. So which means that you have about tens of terabytes of storage, not really gigabytes or petabytes of storage. The second reason is because this content is long tail, any caching mechanism will have to evict these caches periodically based on the popularity of titles. Okay, so you have to actually decide which titles that you want to store at the edge locations. And three, with the increase in the number of bit rates that you're actually streaming, these media segments are becoming larger, which actually puts extra pressure on your storage. So what that means is that popular title does very well because it's being requested multiple times per day. It's already warmed in the cache and it's able to deliver that content well to your end users. But the less popular content is not. And the reality is these set of less popular titles does matter to your customers. And it is important to measure that quality at that fairly granular level. So what did we build? So we had three things that we had to actually change in our network. So the first thing that we did was we said, well, let's actually try and deliver this content over traditional, what we call as classic CDN, okay? This is the CDN that's available today, 53 edge locations spread throughout the world on CloudFront. And we had the exact same pattern. We saw really popular titles have good quality experience for their end users, but as the popularity reduced, that experience was not something that we were proud of. So we had to build a mechanism in place such that we can handle this long tail content. So we created three separate layers. Traditional CDNs merge the caching layer and the network layer. And what that means is if you want to increase your cache width or if you want to increase the amount of bandwidth that you deliver from these locations, you have to go ahead and increase your storage and you have to increase your network. Now, as I said, these colo facilities were small. They did not have the amount of storage that you could actually carry. The second, so what we had to do was we had to separate out the network layer from the storage layer. What that allowed us to do was independently scale the storage layer, increase the cache width, and independently scale the network layer. So what we created at the network layer was an internal network that was an interconnect fabric. And that fabric acted as the aggregation point for transit providers and peering providers to come into our network. And this is actually super important. If you went to any transit provider and the plethora of transit providers that we connect with, they actually incur costs every time they have to interconnect with your infrastructure. So if you went and tell them, well, I have 50 locations and I'm going to increase that to 100 locations, I want connectivity to all these locations, they're probably going to look at you and say, that's going to be a significant portion of my cost, I'm not going to do that. So we created an aggregation layer which is where all these transit providers could come into. Then we created connectivity back to our storage layers that need not be in these transit centers. So that was the second layer that we created. The third part of it was we needed abilities to connect back to our backbone, back to our AWS regions, for any cache misses. That interconnect fabric acted as the aggregation point for the AWS backbone as well. So as you can see in the schematic, you have our transit providers coming into our interconnect fabric. From the interconnect fabric, we have redundant connections to our caching layer, and then we also have a backbone in case we have to actually serve misses. So the benefits of this architecture was improved throughput, because you had direct pairing relationships with major ISPs. You had better caching, because you had petabytes of storage at these edge locations, and you had lower costs. And you had lower costs because you could independently scale both the caching layer and the network layer. To give you a scale, our typical classic CloudFront locations have about terabytes of storage. It's about 50 to 100 terabytes of storage. These locations, which we call internally as metro sites for long-tail video delivery, are about 6 petabytes of storage. So you can see a significant increase in the amount of storage of this content that you can deliver. I'm actually going to talk about two specific results, one set of results that talks about the CloudFront side of the results, and the other one, which is the end user performance. So as Jim mentioned, they actually built a closed loop system which is based on a CDN balancer, which looked at the quality metrics, which is fairly detailed at a per network, per player, per device, and that's how they awarded traffic to different CDNs. And as we saw our quality increase in locations where we deployed these metro locations and we got this connectivity and we scaled the network for the use cases, we saw our quality improve and we saw the amount of throughput that was being delivered through CloudFront increase as well. Now, the next part of the result, which is probably the most important part of this architecture, is there's no point in building this entire architecture if you don't see real benefits to end users. And remember I showed you a slide which showed the number of sessions with errors, the number of sessions with rebuffers, and compared that to the popularity. Traditional CDNs do typically very well on the head of this catalog. Almost all CDNs do very well in terms of being able to cache this popular content, stream this content, and so on. But as the popularity reduced, you saw a fairly significant trade-off that they had to make in terms of quality. And this was the specific part that CloudFront actually improved as part of this architecture. So you saw as the popularity of content reduced, you didn't see this drop-off. And this was primarily responsible for, we believe, the reason why we started serving a lot more of the bits on CloudFront for Amazon Instant Video. Now, in addition to quality of this delivery, there were a lot of things that we had to do which were specific to the device or the player that was being used for consuming this content. I'm not going to go through this exhaustively, but the point I want to make is that you had to measure this quality at a fairly detailed level. That feedback loop told you what you need to improve on the server side. So two of these improvements, one was intelligent prefetching. So what we did was, depending on the bitrate that was being streamed, we would actually prefetch some of these bitrates intelligently based on what we expect the client would actually potentially require. A second improvement we made is what we call as dynamic manifest support. So some of these players, they actually require an optimal bitrate setting, an optimal set of bitrates available for it to improve the playback experience. And we had to change the manifest file dynamically such that we provided these players with those bitrates depending on the specific networks they were in. Of course, as I mentioned, Amazon Video is a large customer of AWS. This platform is being built across all our customers. We have many media customers in this space. We're actually using this platform today. I've talked about delivery. Now let me talk about something which is on the processing stage. Okay. Many of you might have heard, we actually announced the acquisition of Elemental Technologies. Elemental is based out of Portland. They're actually pioneers in software-defined video solutions for multi-screen video delivery. They have a broad range of customers in this segment. They deliver to a plethora of devices. They have some of the best-in-class video quality in terms of the number of encodes that they do. They support HEVC, They were, in fact, I think the first to support HEVC in full form. They delivered to a broad range of devices. And if I look through their software-based solutions, they actually started with Elemental Server, which is their VOD platform, moved on to delivering Elemental Live, which is the real-time encoder, and quite recently, in the last year or so, have developed a platform called, a service called Elemental Delta. Elemental Delta is the origination server for CDNs and for content delivery. The good thing about their solution is it's purely software-based, which means that you can, customers can deploy these solutions either on-prem, on their own custom devices, or Elemental devices. They can deploy this as hybrid architectures, which means that you could run this in a virtualized environment or either on-prem or burst into the cloud for your needs. You could deploy Elemental completely in the cloud, and they call that platform the Elemental Cloud. It actually runs on AWS, and we have at least two customers who are using it completely on AWS. BBCI Player is built on Elemental Cloud on AWS today. So this is giving a choice for customers, depending on where they are on their life cycle for video processing. You can either deploy it on-prem, you can deploy it as a hybrid architecture, or you can deploy it in the cloud. Let me tell you about, this is a quality presentation, so let me talk about some of the achievements that Elemental has had in the last few years. They are the only certified real-time encoder, which is certified by THX Digital Cinema HD Video Encoder Certification. And that certification is fairly stringent, has about 46 or so critical tests over six different categories. It includes machine and GoldenEye testing. And that certification is based on H.264 and 1080p30. That range of customers go from pay TV operators, some of the biggest names in the industry today, from Comcast to Sky to DirecTV and so on, to content owners like HBO, PBS, Turner, to customers in a broad range of segments from sports to broadcast to universities to government. So, parting thoughts. I started with saying how quality is super important for a delivery experience for your end users. And we said this long tail of content, which is where we believe video is going to be in the coming years. And it's important for you to look at your quality for that long tail video content as well. We believe we've actually delivered an architecture for Amazon Video and for our customers and actually improves the quality of this long tail video delivery. And you can see that from the results that we've seen in terms of rebuffer sessions and the number of errors that you see per session. And as the popularity of this content keeps reducing, you don't see that steep drop off that's traditional for most CDNs. On that note, thank you very much for coming to this presentation. There's some related sessions that I'd like you to go to if you have the time to. This session is about raising the bar on video quality. There's a separate session on securing content on Amazon CloudFront. There's a separate session where we have our developers talking about performance, availability, and cacheability. In addition to that, some related sessions include a session on Route 53. It's a fairly detailed session and how to actually do DNS management on Route 53. And finally, this was a popular session for us last year on DDoS mitigation capabilities. What can you do to protect against DDoS on AWS platform? Thank you very much.